Okay, so this is a scene. I will just go through the dialogues. I found it very difficult to understand in the beginning. This is the guy who was walking up the stair. His name is Eduardo, and he's walking up the stair, and the other guy with the laptop is Mark, and this is how the dialogue goes. It is done, perfect timing. Eduardo is here, he has the basic ingredient. It's him. Of course, let's forget about this. Eduardo, you and Erica picked up. Let's not worry about it. Okay. That happens very often in that country, so we'll not worry about it. So how did you know that? Well, everybody knows it. It's on your blog. And yeah, are you all right? I need you. I'm here for you. No, I'm not bothered about all that. I need your algorithm for the rating chess players. Are you okay? Yes, we are rating girls. Okay. You mean the other students, okay. Yeah. Do you think it's such a good idea? Maybe yes or no. I need your algorithm and I need your algorithm. So he goes on. With each girl's base rating as 1400, and he proceeds to write this formula. That's the large formula you saw on the board, okay. And Mark's observation was this. When any two girls are matched up, the expectation that which will win based on the current rating, all right, and all these expectations are done this way. This is the conversation. So there is, people use mathematics even in movies, okay? So unfortunately, well, I will come back to that question shortly about the main idea is that equation, okay? That's what I was interested in. And that equation was wrong, okay? Mathematicians go to movie even to find mistakes in the equation. That's the unfortunate thing, okay? That the equation was wrong in the sense that probably you should give him the benefit of doubt. He was writing with a crayon on the glass window, and so probably he forgot to put a few things here and there. Okay, I'll go back to that equation, and the movie is about the formation, the founding of the social network Facebook, which was preceded by Face Mash, that picture that was shown, the Face Mash, okay. This was the cast. These were the three basic founders of the social, the Facebook, okay. Now, that movie won several awards, and I'm not going to bother about that. So now, that they were rating girls, okay, in that movie. So basically, the problem is about rating. Everybody don't care what we rate, rate girls or rate a football team, rate a cricket team, or whatever you want to do, who are interested in rating and ranking, okay. So what is rating, what is ranking? So rating means you're given an N objects. These could be N girls, as Mark Zuckerberg says there, or N cricket teams, or N chess players, or whatever it is, N objects, and you want to assign N real numbers. Preferably non-negative, preferably distinct, with each numbers, one each to each number. That's called a rating. So the rating can be a number like minus 42 also. Okay. Preferably would like to be positive. A ranking is again n objects. You want to assign the numbers 1, 2, 3, n for these n objects. You are number 1, you are number 2, number 3. So rating is like your marks. You are given 60 marks in physics, 48 marks in chemistry, and so on and so forth. Ranking is what is your rank in the university? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's a whole, the number in that order. Okay. Obviously, given any rating, you can put the rates in the decreasing order, you will get a ranking automatically. So every rating rises to a ranking. Okay. So, how good is a human being in rating? Okay. The psychologists find that anything bigger than five objects, human beings find it very difficult to rate. Okay. They find it extremely difficult to rate. But however, we are very good in pairwise comparison. He is better than me. He is faster than me, he is richer than me, his car is better than mine. All kinds of pairwise comparison we are able to do, But when the size of the objects increase, then human beings have a great difficulty in rating. Okay. So therefore, most of the methods and the algorithms for rating and ranking will always involve this pairwise rating somehow. Okay. That's where we are good at. Whatever we are good at, we want to exploit it as much as possible to do things which are difficult. Okay. So we are going to exploit this pairwise rating. Okay. What are the general mathematical things that come into the picture? Of course, the ubiquitous linear algebra will always be there. If it is not there, I'll put it there. Okay. It has to be there. Okay. And of some kinds of optimization, there are Markovian methods, there are game theoretic methods, there are several methods in rating and ranking. I am not going to go through all of them. I am going to not harass you with all this messy mathematics. I am just going to indicate to you, focus on that wrong formula that fellow wrote on the board and try to get it focus on that, okay, the correct formula. And what is the logic behind it, what goes on into it. Okay. Now, before I go to this rating and ranking, one must keep in mind this famous work of Arrow's impossibility theorem. How many of you are familiar with it? Good. So I can tell you anything I want. So it's like this. If you look at our elections, it's a mess. Elections are mess everywhere. Okay. People, 50% of the people are at most vote. Out of which somebody gets 27% votes, which means he has got about 10 to 12, 14% of the total votes, but then he wins and he becomes whatever he is, he rules. Okay. So therefore, people in the political science and other departments have been studying as to what should we do, what is a correct democratic voting system. Okay. Then this guy Arrow wrote a PhD thesis, Kenneth Arrow wrote a PhD thesis in 1951, okay, and he proved known as, instead of asking the question, what is the best electoral system, he asked the question, is there a best electoral system? And his answer, he found, was no. What he meant was, no matter what you do, there is none. This is a negative result in the sense non-existence. There cannot be any perfect election system. I will do it in a way, I will just tell you what it is in an intuitive manner. Okay. So Arrow put a few criteria. I will just put some of the important ones here. Now, what are these four criteria? These four criteria are about what should be a good election system. What should be, what are the features that a good electoral system must have? The first one is that everybody must have a vote. Everybody must have a choice to vote. He said then, don't vote, I should not say, you elect this fellow, if you put a vote to this fellow, you cannot vote that fellow. What he said was, take all the candidates and rank them. This fellow is number one for me, this fellow is number two for me, number three for me. So there is a ranking already. Okay. So he is talking about ranking of the candidates. And everybody, every electorate must have the choice, must have the freedom to give his or own, her own choice. Okay. And this is called, okay, I will just skip the names. And then this is a very important axiom. It says this is what ruins all our elections, this being not there. What this says is this ruined even as late as about 2000, in the year 2000, the election between George Bush and Al Gore, which ended up in a mess, and Al Gore finally got fed up and said, okay, you win, I don't want to get on with this anymore. And that is because this axiom was not there. Okay. This axiom simply says the following. Suppose two candidates A and B are there in the electoral list, and I rank A as number one and rank B as number two. What does it mean? For me, B is below A. Now, suppose there is a third candidate C, Now I want to rank ABC. My ranking must be such that at no, I should not now, because he has come, I move B above A. If B was below A, he remains below A all the time. So this is the irrelevant alternatives. The other fellow C is an irrelevant alternative when I am comparing A and B. So he said, whatever subset you take, that original order must be maintained in the subsets also. The third one is, of course, obvious statement. If everybody has voted me at number one, I should be number one. The final, I don't think the election commissioner should make a mess of saying I am not number one. Many times this has happened that you are not number one. Well, I'll come to that example. This is called Pareto principle. And the other one is, of course, non-dictatorship. No one single voter should have a complete command to dictate who wins the election. And all of them look to be very simple, common sense, and a natural thing to have a good electoral system. And what Arrow proved was that it is impossible to have an electoral system in which all these four are satisfied. When he says impossible, it means that simply does not exist. In mathematics, there are non-existence theorem. No matter how many years you try, it will not be there. It is just not there. Okay, there is no system which satisfies all these four axioms. Okay. So therefore, let us keep at the back of our mind, in a sense, there is no perfect ranking system. There is no perfect ranking system. That's what Arrow says. Okay. And of course, Arrow is well known for his PhD thesis, but though for many other things he got the Nobel Prize in 1972. Probably most of you were not, with probability 1.8, nobody was born, okay, in the audience except me. It was for general equilibrium theory and social welfare theory and things like that. He got the Nobel Prize in 1972, but is most well known for his impossibility theorem. Okay. So whenever we do rating and ranking, we better keep at the back of our mind there is no perfect ranking system in the sense of Arrow. Okay. So with that humbling thought, but we still have to do some things as reasonably satisfactory. We have to run our show, we have to have presidents, like them or not, we have to have prime ministers, like them or not, and we have to have ministers, like them or not. So some kind of adjustments, thoda adjust karna padega. Okay, so we'll have to adjust. So therefore, many of these rating systems have led to a lot of controversies. Okay, lot of heartburns, lot of controversies. I told you about the Pareto principle and if somebody is number one, he should be always number one. If everybody chooses him as number one and so on. There is one important controversy I would like to point out. This is called the Bowl Championship Series. This is the American college football. Okay, in American college, America, they are mad about some stupid games. One of the stupid game is football. I was also stupid to be mad about it. Okay, and there are several regions in the, I'll just briefly describe. There are several regions in the country. They are divided into several conferences, they call. From each one, some people are picked, and finally at the end of the year, there are four major championship called bowl championship, and then finally the national championship games. And in order to pick the teams who participate in this championship, because there is a lot of money involved eventually in all these things, there is certain ranking that has to go on, rating and ranking. Based on the rating and ranking on the performance during that current year, the teams are chosen for this. And this has led to a lot of controversies. This has been there since 1998. Of course, ever since it started, there has been a problem. By the way, the basic method, the fundamental idea in this ranking that they use in BCS was originally suggested by an undergraduate student, Massey. Okay, so it's not that it's not time for you to start doing research. The best research is done by undergraduate students, okay, or graduate students. By the time you become professor, not only best research, you don't do research, okay? You better start teaching, okay? That's the only thing you can do, okay? Anyway, so this was originally suggested by an undergraduate student. I will just describe message system quickly. Well, I am not going to describe it at all. It is based on linear algebra, okay? And very simple linear systems and least square solutions which form in every first course linear algebra ITMAS. And the slightly modified version is what is known in this is. There is one more system in the Macy system. The basic ingredient that is used to rank is the result of a game, the results of the game. What was the score difference in each game? Somebody won 48-32 is the result of the game. Spread is 16, 48 minus 32, that 16 is the spread. That spread is used in of all the games. The result, the score, the end score or the score line of the game is used in all this ranking. Then there's another one that was given by Cauley, which goes on dynamically updating the ranking. But his method is the ranking basic ingredient is not the score spread, but the winning ratio, the winning percentage. Out of so many games, I have won, out of TINI games, he has won WI games, that the 1 and the 2, they are put there in order to avoid some difficulties, and they also have some connection with what is known as the Laplace's law of succession in statistics, but we will not go into that. So basically, it looks a good system in the sense that if you have sufficiently large number of games and you have won half of them exactly, your ranking comes as half. Okay. So therefore, so suppose WI, if he has played 100 games and 50 has won, total is 100, the ratio is exactly half. So therefore, it looks like a reasonably good system. So Cauley system takes care of the win-loss or win-loss proportion, whereas Massey's method takes care of the score proportion. You can use any one of these statistics. These are all some of the statistics generated by a game. Okay. Now, this raised a hell of a lot of controversy right from the beginning. It's so much so, in the 2008, in the presidential election campaign, when Obama was asked, what will you change in sports, he said, I'll change this BCS. And then in 2009, he, after getting elected, the president-elect said, no, I don't. I would like to point out this. He says, if I'm Utah. See, that year, the problem with the University of Utah was, it was undefeated. It ended up the season undefeated, but it was still ranked number 24. It created a lot of heartburns, and in fact, one professor from Utah even wrote a paper, should Utah be ranked number 24? That was one of his papers. Okay. So anyway, and it was even so bad that one of the senators from Utah wrote to the Justice Department that this whole thing must be investigated, there is some antitrust law involved. The Americans are crazy, for anything and everything they will bring in all kinds of laws. But the important thing is they follow it up. Okay. In 2011, the Justice Department put the BCS on hold. Look, we are investigating your whole system with this, and by 2012, they said, look, you are finished. We are going to follow some other system. We are not satisfied with your BCS system. So therefore, this whole thing will go on creating controversy. People keep on creating several ranking and rating systems. So as long as it creates controversy, it's good, because now we can work on something else, okay, another system. So it's never ending. And as long as arrow is there to tell us there is no perfect system, we can go on proposing many, many, many systems. Okay. If there was a perfect system, people would ask, give me the perfect system. Now there is no perfect system. So we can go on giving several imperfect systems. Now, coming back to the movie, In the movie, the fellow who plays the role of Mark Zuckerberg asked his friend Eduardo, "I want your ranking, the algorithm that you use to rank chess players." Okay, and now I'm going to get into this. Basically, if you understand this modeling, that same type of modeling and modify, change, and do whatever you want, and you can even analyze the IPL games or the Championship League or World Cup, whatever you want, every one of these sports events that takes place. I have this hobby. I even do a ranking at the end of the season, my own, of the local hockey league, Bangalore Hockey League, Bangalore Soccer League, and even the sometimes the cricket league. I do a ranking of which is the best team which bowls the with as far as dot balls in a match are concerned. How many dot balls are bowled? So all kinds of ranking and rating can be done to analyze. If you are a coach to a team, you must analyze the weaknesses and strengths of your team. Okay, so this ELO system was developed by a Hungarian-born physicist cum mathematician. He was himself a great chess player, and therefore he ended up generating this efficient method. Okay, very nice method. His system is used by the United States Chess Federation, the International Chess Federation, and it's also used in many other sports. Okay, so now I'm going to quickly describe to you what is this, because I have to finish by 11 o'clock, I guess. So what is the basic ingredient? Remember the conversation that Mark has in the movie, when two girls are matched up, the expectation who will win is based on their current rating. That's what exactly he says. So the performance of a player is based on his current performance. So you have to analyze his performance, and ELO's basic assumption was this was a normal distribution. Anything and everything, first thing you do is normal distribution. It is the most abnormal thing to do in this case. Anyway, this is a normal distribution, and keep updating the rank as follows. Let me first write what it is. Suppose before the start of the game, the ranking of the player I is Ri. We are starting the game between player I and player J. Okay. Now we have a game starting with player I and player J. Before starting the game, the standing of the player I was rank I, and the player J is rank J. Now after the game, we have to update the rank. So that we will call it as Ri new. So Ri old is the rating that player has before the game, and Ri new is the rating of the player after the game as a result, as a consequence of how he performed in the game. Okay. Now, how are these two? How the updating takes place? How is Ri old? How are Ri old and Ri new connected? So obviously, it goes around like this, because it's a normal distribution. It's, let's say mu is the average score, okay, up till now, and S is the score in the game, in the new game, and then S minus mu is the variation. Mu is the expectation, the average score, and S is the score in this game. He might have scored above the expectation or below the expectation. So S minus mu is the variation. So therefore, this has to be playing a role in the updating. This is basically a measure of his performance in the game. So this measure has to play a role in the updating of the rank. Okay. So what ELO said was very simple. He said the updating must be proportional to this performance. The old rank plus something proportional to that variation. K is the constant of proportion. So it should be old plus some correction. The new ranking must be the old ranking plus a correction. that correction is proportional to the variation of the performance. Okay, k is the constant of proportion. Originally, Yellow gave k equal to 10. Okay, all right. That was a very simple model, which was proposed by Yellow, but it was not as these statistics for chess games became more and more available. Of course, for any chess game, win is 1-1, s is 1, 1 point for a win, half point for a stalemate, and 0 points for a loss. That's a standard score. You can use any other scoring scheme. Okay, I'll come back to that later. Okay, so modification. So as more and more statistics started coming out, they found that it is not a normal distribution. So it has to be modified. And the formula was changed. I'll come to this and come to the current formula. What is the current usage of this formula? And we'll see how it is done. Suppose Pi plays Pj. Now again, the game is between the ith player and the jth player. And Sij means if I wins against j. If I put Sji, I mean j score against I. If I put Sij, it is I score against j. So Sij is 1 if I wins, half if I ties, and 0 if I loses. And now mu ij is what you expect Pa to score against j. That is average expectation. Now you see the expectation previously was a constant. Now it is a player dependent, the team dependent. Depending on whom I play, what is my expectation? It is like when I play Bangladesh, India plays Bangladesh, hopefully they are expected to win. Sometimes they lose, but they are expected to win. So, not a big deal if they win. That aspect must be taken into account. But if India, if for example, our IASC team, cricket team, I'm not a member, I hope Balmurugan or somebody is a member. Suppose our IASC cricket team plays the Indian cricket team. Now, there is a rating for IASC cricket team, maybe 1042 or something like that. And the rating for the Indian cricket team, they have 5. Now, if Indian cricket team beats IASC cricket team, it should not be given 1 point. Because anyway, it was expected to get 1 point. But if IASC beats Indian cricket team, then there will be chaos in IASC. The thing is, we must give a lot of points to IASC, then more credit to for the low ranked team for beating the high ranked team. So this aspect is brought into this picture. Depending on whom you are playing, what are your relative strengths, what are your relative ranks, based on that your updating must take place. It's not just simply, it may happen that you beat 3 bad teams, very poor teams, and score in a World Cup match 6 points and lose to the only good team. And the other good team, poor fellows, all their 3 matches with the other fellows were tied, rained. So they got 1-1 point and 3 plus 2, 5. Whereas the other fellow got 3 into 2, 6 points and he goes. It's ridiculous. That is how World Cup works. Okay, it's absolutely ridiculous way of rating, and ALO will not allow it. Okay, in fact, they should switch over to such rating systems where the weightage of the game is also brought into the picture. So mu ij is the score that Pi is expected to get against Pj, and the dij is the rate differential or rating differential. What was the rating of I at the start of the game? What is the rating of J at the start of the game? Okay. So, what is the rating difference? So, therefore, based on Dij, the credit must be given to the winning score. Okay. Not full score should be given. If the rating differential is very small, then the credit will be good. If the rating differential is very large positive, then it has to be less. So, the formulation went as follows. They said that mu ij, the expected value follows a logistic car rather than the normal car. I'll show you a picture where LX is this, and so therefore what is the correction? The correction should be proportional to not S minus mu as ILO originally proposed. It should be proportional to Sij minus mu ij. That was the correction that was introduced in the rating system of J. So the mu ij becomes this. By the way, do you recognize that formula now? That's exactly what that guy wrote, except he forgot to put this on the exponent, but put it as a product. So that is the mistake that Eduardo does when he writes it on the board, on the glass panel. So that is the correct formula. The expectation the expected value of I while he plays against J. Look at here, for example, when the differential is very large, that is RI is a very strong player. His rating is very high compared to the rating of O. So this is very large. So what happens to this? Very small. So almost out of one point is taken away. So you will get very little credit for winning the game against that fellow. But suppose that is zero. They are equal ranked players. You get exactly half credit. Okay. So that's a reasonably good proposition. This is the current rating system. So this is how the logistic curve looks like. Okay. That LX. Okay. It slowly rises, comes to half at zero, and when the differential goes, it goes on approaching the one. This is a very famous curve known as the logistic curve in mathematics. Okay. So this is the current this thing RI, the K factor. This is how Chess Federation used. This is the rating that is used by the Chess Federation, and the ratings are as like this. If you are a new player, you are get a lot, the proportion constant is higher because you are a weak player, and as you play more and more games, then you are going to get less and less credit for your wins. You have got to work hard more to raise your rating. Okay. And you have to work hard to keep your rating intact. It should not become negative. Okay. So that's the current status. Okay. As I pointed out here, that you for beating a stronger player, you get better rewards. For example, in the ELO system of rating. Okay. Let us stay. What is the reward? The reward is that. That is the correction, right? That is the correction factor over and above the old rating. You are going to get it. If it is negative, the reward is negative. If it is positive, the reward is positive. And if we expand it and write it with all the formulae I have, so the reward for I is that, and the reward for J is this. I will give you a small example. Suppose I have a chess rating of 1700 and I play against a player whose chess rating is 2100. Suppose the strong fellow beats the weak fellow, what does he get? That's what he gets, and that's equal to that, and that is how much he gets? 0.91 k, because T1 is the weak player, so he gets a good rating, good reward. Whereas suppose the strong player wins, what is the reward he gets? Not much, only 0.09 times k, because after all you are expected to win. So this is a system which adjusts the fact that depending on whom you beat, you are going to get the points. Okay, so this is a very nice adjustment system, and the Federation fellows are very happy with this system. It is going on. Now I think I will skip all these calculations. Oh, by the way, there is a very interesting property of this system, that the total expectation remains 1, because the total number of points in a game is 1. Okay, the expected value of I and the expected value of J together must be 1. Okay, so that always is maintained, so that's not affected at all in all these mess calculations. Finally, that common sense prevails. Okay, that is maintained. The total expected value for the game is 1, because it's 1 point for each game. Okay, and similarly, the total score remains one. That is also correct. That's how it should be, because if that fellow gets one, I get zero. If I get one, he gets zero. If he gets half, I also get half. So the total score is always one. But the most interesting thing is the total rating remains the same. I'll just write the whole proof here. See, the sum of all the ratings to start with are the same as the sum of all the ratings at the end of the game, the updated ones. In other words, if somebody gained, somebody lost. If somebody gained in his rating, somebody would have certainly lost in the rating, and the total rating will remain the same. So that's another good thing about it. This helps in computations, because then we can normalize that the total rate sum is 1, or total sum is 0, or whatever normalization you want to do, and make your computations easy. Okay. So that is one simple model of rating. Now you see, this is nothing to do with chess. It has nothing to do with score. You could have made that Sij to be the number of dot balls the player I bowled against J, and Sji to be the number of dot balls J bowled against I, may be divided by the number of overs to normalize things to be common for all of them, and then analyze the weaknesses and the strengths of the bowling teams as far as dot balls. Or you can take about the wicket taking balls. Like this, in the US football, they have got the odds gained, defense, offense, all kinds of data, statistics. Every game produces several statistics, and every statistic can be analyzed by any one of these ways, and the teams can be ranked or as far as the bowling strength is concerned, wicket taking strength is concerned, batting strength is concerned, and winning strength is concerned. All kinds of ratings can be done by this very simple model of ELO, and it's one of the most popular models because it does not involve very complicated mathematics. It is a very simple mathematics. The variations people still probably are questioning or analyzing is the following. Why do I want base 10 logistic? Why not base E logistic, which is common? Or why not a base 2 logistic, which will make computations easier? Okay, so all kinds of questions that arise about it. And the other thing that arises is, what about this K factor, wherever that? Okay, I gave you that constant of proportionality factor. So what about that constant of proportionality factor? So these are some of the things that can be done. Of course, this is not the only system of rating. There are many, many, many systems of rating. And as I said, it will involve a little bit of linear algebra, a little bit of optimization. And I will bring you one of the simplest optimizations now. And of course, many other, like Markovian models you can use. That as you grow, as you start picking up, you will start picking up. Okay. So the idea is the same. Every game has a payoff for each person. How do you model that payoff? Based on that payoff, how do you rate? And based on the rating, you rank. This is the general theme of all these models. Okay. Game generates a statistic. You decide on the statistic that you are interested in, and then model that statistic as a payoff by whichever model you want. Use that model to rate, and use that rate to rank. Okay. So my title had rating, ranking, then there was betting. Okay. So I'm going to talk something about betting. Of course, I said and mathematics. Mathematics all the time is everywhere there. So I'm going to talk about betting. We have seen a lot of spot fixing and all kinds of nonsense that goes on, but I am not interested in betting at all. The betting idea leads to some other ideas. Okay. So here is a guy whose name, he was the man who invented this idea of spread betting. I will show you, if you look at Wikipedia, this is what I got in Wikipedia's profile. Interestingly, he has a master's degree in mathematics. And he taught in a school, Riverdale School. It's a very famous private school in the United States, pre-college school. And one of his students was even John F. Kennedy. Okay. And probably that led him to getting into securities and other things, this thing. But he was also at the same time doing gambling on the side, and that introduced the idea of spread betting. Okay, so the spread betting is what? Betting means usually we say, okay, we'll bet India is going to win the finals, or England is going to win the finals. Bet it, bet. Okay, let's bet. But then this guy introduced the idea exactly at the time when in Las Vegas betting was made legal. It was in 1931. Okay. And what he did was, well, if that sort of betting is there, it's not going to be very profitable. Because if, for example, if England is going to play Zimbabwe or Bangladesh, this, everybody will bet on England. They're going to, it's not got a big payoff and not a very interesting betting. Okay. Even in betting, there should be some interest. Okay. So what he did was, okay, England will beat India by 25 runs. So the spread of score by which they will win. And that he introduced. So that's called a spread betting. Okay. So anyway, he himself started a betting company, and now it is used in all sports. Because in India, betting is not legal, but other countries it is. He started his own company. Okay. So now let's see. So therefore, they call beat the spread. This is the standard phrase. Okay. So that's called that is the holy grail of the betting world. Okay. Beat the spread. What does it mean? There's a McNeil's betting company. Today, for example, there is a basketball game between IISc and IIT Madras. And McNeil's company will put on the published spread as IISc beat IIT Madras by 18 points. Okay. Now you can bet on IISc or you can bet on IIT Madras. Now if you bet on IISc, you get paid only if IISc wins by at least 18 points. Even if IISc wins by 17 points, you lose. If I bet on IIT, I win if either IISc loses or IISc wins by less than 18 points. So this is what is called spread betting. So this gives a lot of scope for people to bet. So what does the betting? So this is what I meant. Okay, instead of IISc, IIT. So this is how the match goes. If you bet on IA, this will happen, and you bet on B, that will happen. Okay. Okay. Similarly, the other bet. Okay. Okay. So I think I'll skip that. Okay. So in order to avoid ties, they will announce the spread in half score, 8.5 or 7.5 and 8. Otherwise, there will be a tie. Suppose exactly 10, what do you do? So therefore, this is what is done. Now, what I am interested in, how do I use the spread of the game to for a rating? This again, the spread in the game is used for rating. Now, there is again a little bit of linear algebra is involved, which I will skip. So what do I do? So what I do is, I consider a tournament with n players where each player plays the other player once, okay, round robin, what they call as a round robin tournament. Okay. Of course, you can complicate it by this, but the simple model is this. So let Sij be the score of Ti against Tj, okay, and the Sji will be the score of J against it. So this is the spread, Sij minus Sji. Okay. Note that Sj, the reverse will be for the other fellow. Now we got to construct a matrix, okay, whose entries are this Sij. Okay, so I constructed an n by n matrix. Okay, from initially make a sports into matrix and make money. Okay, this is a skew symmetric matrix. The diagonal entries are 0. Whatever is here is negative is here because Sij is equal to minus Sji. So this is a skew symmetric matrix, and that's one matrix. The other matrix is the ranking vector. So suppose I have a rank, any rank. Suppose I rank the teams as x1, x2, x3, not rank, rate. I rate the teams as x1, x2, xn. The first team given a rating of x1 is a number, real number. Second team is given a rating of x2 and so on and so forth. And then I construct a rating spread matrix, which is xij. Xij is ri minus rj. This is the spreading of the rating, that is the spreading of the scores. Now, by fluke, if we have this, the spreading is equal to the spreading matrix is equal to the rating matrix, then we can very well model rank the teams exactly based giving credit for the spread of each game. Okay, so the rating matrix is equal to spreading matrix, so we know what exactly xi, x1, x2, x3, what the rating is, but it is impossible to get such a thing. Okay, as Arrow says, there is no perfect this thing. So what can we do? I want to get a rating x such that s is equal to x. The rating must reflect the spreading that has happened during the season in each match. Okay, but unfortunately there is no such. Whenever there is no such, you approximate. Whenever you want to approximate, you minimize the error. Okay, so what do I do? I want to approximate, I want to minimize that error. This is a matrix, this is a matrix, so the difference is a matrix, so I have an error, so I have to quantify that error. I want to say the error as a number, so I want to quantify that matrix error. So how do I quantify a matrix? There is a wonderful norm called the Frobenius norm, which is simply think of the matrix as a vector where all these entries as a component, calculate the length of the vector, sum of the squares of all the entries. So the Frobenius norm is essentially the sum of the matrix treated as an n squared vector, okay, and add all the components squared. So what I want to do is, I want to get a rating such that if I look at the rate spread matrix and the score spread matrix, the error must be smaller than every other error that you will get from other ratings. So in other words, we want the best rating possible which reflects this spread. Okay, what is the best rating that reflects this spread? Very beautiful, simple mathematics tells us, well, there is only one such rating and that rating can be easily got. How do I get that R from the S? Because I know the score of each game. What you do is, you have the matrix S. How many columns it has? N columns. Take the columns and add them and take the average. So take the centroid of the columns. Okay. So the centroid of the columns gives precisely that best rating. Common sense. Whenever you are in doubt, take the average. And that common sense works. The centroid of the columns gives the best rating that reflects that spread. Okay, and so I'm running out of time. So let me see. So now conclusion. Good. Okay. Well, of course, we should not know whether Mark Zuckerberg used that formula that Eduardo gave to rank hot girls at Harvard. Only he knows. Now I suppose you can try ELOs in your university or in your institution. The boys can rank the girls or the girls can rank the boys. But however, I will go to Shakespeare, one of my favorites. Okay, I would like to give a quote from Shakespeare. Here is a thing from Love's Labor Lost, which essentially said, come on, you can't be rating and ranking mathematics by beauty of a girl by all the nonsensical things. And probably if Shakespeare were alive, he would have added another line, nor rated by heartless mathematicians' equations. Okay. Well, similar views are expressed by others, but the most popular one is this, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. It's not in any equation. Okay. So don't ever waste your time rating girls. Okay. Now, the poets therefore say the beauty of a girl cannot be ranked. Arrow say the beastly politicians cannot be ranked. That reminds me of a very famous commercial which said there are some things money cannot buy, for everything else there is MasterCard. So I will say there are some things that science cannot rate, rank, or baton. For everything else, there is mathematics. Thank you very much.
You have any questions?
Oops. Yeah. I was running away from questions. Okay. Don't ask me whether I rated any hot girl any time. Okay. Anything else you can ask?
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, in the rating system,
yes.
What are the mechanisms used to avoid the clashes of rank?
See, that's what I mean. You are talking about ties. So obviously, you see, when you have a tie, you got to bring in another parameter, one more aspect. What do you do in the World Cup matches, for example? The tie, you go to run rate. If the run rate is also not there, if this team fellow has bet that team fellow, and so on and so forth. So therefore, other parameters start coming into the picture. All things being equal, let's look at something else.
Okay. Might be embedded into the formula.
See, there are some primary parameters. Secondary parameters. The primary parameters decide, like in our presidential election system, if the first voting decides, we don't bother about the second vote. Then only we go to the, if there is some problem, if it doesn't get a majority, we go to the second voting. So there are primary parameters, secondary parameters, tertiary parameters, and so on. I remember when my daughter passed her 12th standard, there was the CET in Karnataka. I didn't know how they do this ranking after the CET, and so I phoned the director of technical education, when Dr. Satyanarayan Shetty was there. I asked him, how do you do this ranking of the students? There is the PUC mark, there is the entrance test, they combine them, then you have to rank them, and there may be many places where there may be equal numbers and so on. Then he said, sir, you wait for half an hour. I didn't know. He said, okay, I thought he was in a meeting or something like that. In half an hour, he was in my room in the institute. He gave me a booklet and said, sir, you read this, sir, you will get the answer to your question. The booklet was so beautifully prepared. It clearly gave the flow chart, how the ranking. If at this stage you are tied, how the suppression takes place. Maths marks. If maths marks are tied, then physics marks. If physics marks are tied, then chemistry marks. All kinds of possibilities have been handled. The probability that even after all these there will be a tie was also taken care of. I mean, that was very small, very, very small, because I myself sat down and calculated the probability. But then I was about to ask him what will happen, but then I saw the answer for that also, how they handle that also. So there are the several levels of important parameters which they can take care of. Yes.
Any other questions?
Hello, sir. Sir, my question is, if I choose three to four ranking systems to rank a particular situation.
Good.
At the end, how do I merge them all? I'm getting several rankings.
Yes, I told you, the ranking is always, there's no perfect ranking.
Yes.
So there's bound to be, therefore, different ranking systems. I will give you, I already told you about Massey, I told you about Cauley, I told you about ELO and various variations of ELO. Okay, there are things, there is a paper by Keener, I said to the fellow who wrote, should Utah be ranked 24? He has a paper in which he has written various types of ranking, he compares and how in a known data, how it works and so on and so forth. Okay, so basically, the analysis has been done. Okay, it is like this. If you take, you have heard of the Netflix, website Netflix, which rents movies and ranks movies based on the viewers, things like that. On Netflix, for example, or on the large data of the European football and the world football teams' performances, so the American football, all these data, the various methods have been applied. Okay. And the interesting thing is, the ranking will change, because if, but the interesting thing is, if you take the top 100, many movies. If you take the top 20 movies, the top 20 movies are the same, but slightly the order is changed. Like if you are going to take 5,000 students in IIT, the top 5,000 ranks, the set is same. The order may slightly different, but all of them are going to get the seat. So this is not really very seriously changing the ranks. Okay, so basically most of these methods that have been developed very carefully. But if you want very particularly 1, 2, 3, 4, they will change. Because Arrow says you don't have a perfect ranking system. Each one has its own defect or its own preferences. This fellow wants to give more weightage to this, another fellow wants to give more weightage to this. Another interesting question. Suppose I use all these methods and get the ranking and use that to bet and beat the spread. Will I win? 75% of the time you can. But then to have this rank, you should know the spread already. So therefore, the spread ranking is more used to, at the end of the season, how do I select the top 10 teams to play the playoff? Okay, which was the hot one in America about the NCAA and other things. It will be the same in World Cup or anywhere football, what the European Americans call as soccer, but what we call as football. In every one of these sports, it will be there, even in IIT selection or anything like that. But within about 1% error, the top set will remain the same in most of the ranking systems that are known.
Actually, I had done some similar things in MCDM with multi-criteria decision making, and I got some very different results. So I was facing this problem. That's why I asked you that. What is
no? Your ranking, individual ranking may change. Definitely, it will change from system to system. What I am saying is, even though the individual ranks change, the top set will not change. Not very much. The variation will be very small. In most of the ranking system that are being used, it has been tested on data. Okay, you can even predict the spreads in a game. Suppose I do a hindsight prediction. I take the spread and then I do the ranking, as I said in the last, say, one of those methods. I have the ranking. Now I pretend I don't know the outcome of the game, use this ranking matrix to get the spread. I can do a pretty good job of that prediction. Always say there is no perfect job. That you should always keep in mind. There is nothing perfect.
Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Sir, in many of the ranking algorithms, there is one step for normalization.
There are. So I skipped.
Because
for example, I passingly mentioned the number of dot balls per over. For example, winning percentage,
yes,
total
sir.
Number of games played is at the denominator.
Yes,
okay,
sir.
Always the statistic that you choose, finally you get a number Aij that is divided by the total number of games played. That's normalization is done. Or you take a percentage.
Okay.
Yeah, finally the statistic is normalized. Even playing ground for everybody. I count the number of dot balls, I might have bowled more overs than you. So therefore, number of dot balls per over you calculate. So that sort of normalization is.
So, but in case of like ranking and rating, these factors are common for all. So what is the need for
normalization? Simplicity, I took everybody plays the same number of games. But it is not true. The number of games played by teams will be different.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful talk. We'll give a wide round of applause for this.